Good morning and welcome to Blackburn and Seafield Church. It's lovely to be here with you again, and I hope that you're keeping well and safe. And I hope that as we worship this morning, that you experience something of the Lord's presence and his peace. The church will be opening again this Wednesday from 7 till 8 p.m. and this Sunday afternoon from 2 till 3 p.m. if anyone would like some private prayer time in church. We are planning to have the church open next Sunday, the 9th of August. Following the Scottish Government's guidelines of 2 metres social distancing, we're only able to get 35 individual people into the church. So in order to accommodate everyone, we'll be having two services on a Sunday, one at 11 a.m. and the other at 2 p.m. If your surname begins with A to L, you should come to church next week at 11 a.m. And if your surname begins with M to Z, you should come to church at 2 p.m. There's no easy way to decide how we should allocate places at church, and we will no doubt disappoint or even hurt some people, but this is not our intention. Our intention is to put forward a fair and equal way to help everyone return to church safely. You will also find details of which service you should attend in the August edition of the Tally Lamp, which you should have received by now. If you haven't, then please give me a phone and I will organise this. Remembering when we could gather as a congregation, we worship now in our own homes. Remembering how Jesus drew the crowds, we worship knowing he draws us still in solidarity. Remembering how Christ fed the hungry, we worship now for our soul, for food for our soul, each solitary one of us a part of that glorious, noisy throng. Let us worship God. Let us pray. God of miracle and God of every day, may we see you now, healing, feeding, teaching, serving through ordinary people whom you call to be your body in the world today. We thank you that you reveal your love in those around us, and that you can even enable us to step up to be Christ for one another. Lord, forgive us for the times we cannot be bothered, the times we look to our own comfort first and forget that your command is to love one another. And in this moment of silence, we bring to you now those things that we have said and done that have let you down. Faithful God, forgive us and help us to do better. God, in Jesus, you gave us a perfect example. May we keep on learning from him, and may we become imitators of him until we too are sought out by others as people of peace and of love in the name of God, who is love. And hear us as we come together to say the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite Rhoda Drummond to read our scripture lesson for today.
Good morning. Our reading today is from Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 to 21. Jesus feeds the 5,000. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat." "We have only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish," they answered. "Bring them here to me," he said. As he directed the people to sit down in the grass, taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. Amen. Thanks be to God for this reading from his holy word.
Fast food. Today's lesson is one of Jesus' best known miracles, the feeding of the 5,000. Of course, as someone has noted, if Jesus were alive today, he wouldn't be allowed to get away with half the miracles he performed, what with all the red tape involved, never mind 2 metres social distancing. A struggling young minister worked for a catering company to supplement his income. He says this company once served a meal to 3,000 people. The meal included prawns, sliced turkey, fish, spaghetti, salad, bread and tray bakes. It was a monumental task. It took a full week to prepare. 1,000 pounds of prawns, 70 turkeys, 35 pots of spaghetti, 700 pounds of fish, dozens of 3 by 5 feet sheets of tray bakes, and many large tubs of salad. 3,000 people is bad enough, but imagine feeding 5,000 people. No, quadruple that. The scripture says there were 5,000 men, plus women and children. I believe that 5,000 hungry men would be enough to feed, but women and children too? Quite an undertaking, and it had to be done right away. They didn't have a week to prepare, but we're getting ahead of our story. A crowd had followed Jesus out into the wilderness, and evening was approaching. Concerned, the disciples came to the master and said, "This is a remote place and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so that we can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat." Well, you can imagine the disciples' surprise when Jesus said that. He wants them to feed maybe 20,000 people on the spot. "We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. "Bring them to me," Jesus said, and he directed the people to sit down. It was obvious to Jesus that he was in charge of the situation. Taking the 5 loaves and 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 baskets full of broken pieces that were left over. This is an amazing story, one we would do well to study more carefully. Notice, first of all, Jesus' concern for the multitude. Matthew begins this story by saying, "When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick." Nothing new in that. Throughout the Gospels, he shows compassion to the least and the lowest. Jesus came with one purpose and desire, to seek and to save the lost. When he gazed out over Jerusalem, he wept. He knew the heartaches and the hungers that go with being human, bringing the masses from the ends of the earth. The compassionate Christ cares for each and every one. Someone tells of being in the toilet at a coffee shop. Someone wrote on the bathroom wall, "What would Jesus do?" One person answered the question by writing, "Wash his hands." Then a third person wrote, "And your feet." What a wonderful perspective on the nature of Jesus. He would wash our feet. Jesus cares about people. He had compassion for the multitude. Actually, to really appreciate Jesus' love for people, we need to go back a verse further. The story actually begins like this. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. Did you notice that? And Jesus heard what had happened and withdrew to a solitary place. What was it that happened? If we go back a few verses, we discover that Jesus' cousin, John the Baptist, had been beheaded by King Herod. How do you think Jesus felt when he got this news? How would you feel? A family member that you were very close to had been the victim of an atrocious crime. No wonder Matthew said that Jesus withdrew to a solitary place. Don't you think that maybe Jesus wanted to be alone to grieve the death of his cousin? But when Matthew adds, hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. Jesus didn't even have a few moments to grieve. If this had happened to me, the last thing I would feel like doing is seeing a mob of people coming to me for help. But that's me. That's not Jesus. Jesus had compassion for the crowd, and he still gazes upon us with that same compassion today. But there's a second thing we need to see. Not only does he have compassion, but he's also capable. He's competent to do for us more than we are able to imagine. Many people have tried to give a rational explanation for the miracles of the loaves and the fishes. Even in the 20th century, it became fashionable to find natural explanations for miracles. Albert Schweitzer wrote that each of the 5,000 people was so completely impressed in the presence of Jesus that they felt satisfied, even though they weren't actually filled. Another theory was that the crowd brought food with them. When a small boy offered to share his lunch, this shamed others into offering theirs as well. These explanations miss the point, however. The important point of this story is that Jesus is able to supply our needs, no matter how he does it. Our needs may be physical or emotional or spiritual, but Jesus is sufficient. This may be the point at which a lot of us are missing the joy of our faith. We believe that God cares about us and our need, but we don't really believe that God is able to help us. And so we lead joyless, powerless lives. But what good is compassion without capability? Jesus is able. The explorer Richard Byrd spent the summer of 1934 in Bolling Advanced Weather Base in Antarctica. The temperature at this base ranged from 58 to 76 below zero. By the time he was rescued, he was suffering from frostbite and carbon monoxide poisoning. Afterward, he wrote about his experience in a book in which he entitled Alone. Here is how he described his experience. I had hardly strength to move. I clung to the sleeping bag, which was the only source of comfort and warmth left to me, and mournfully debated the little that might be done. Two facts stood clear. One was that my chances of recovering were slim. The other was that in my weakness, I was capable of taking care of myself. But you must have faith. You must have faith in the outcome, I whispered to myself. It is like a fight into another unknown. You start and you cannot turn back. You must go on, trusting your instruments, the course that you have plotted. That sounds very much like the life of faith. You must go on trusting the one who has brought you this far. Jesus is not only capable, but he is not only compassionate, but he is capable. But there is one thing more that needs to be said. Jesus uses what we give him to work with. You may have noticed that in Matthew's telling of the feeding of the 5,000, he doesn't mention the young boy who had with him the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. We have to go to John's Gospel for that detail. But what if that young boy had not been willing to share his 5 loaves and 2 fish? Surely Jesus would have found a way to feed the multitude, but it doesn't seem to be a clear principle of faith that God works best when God has something to work with. It might be fish and bread. It might be a tiny baby hidden in the bulrushes. It might be a shepherd boy guarding his father's sheep. But God needs something or somebody with which to work. There is an article in a magazine a few years ago about a 9-year-old girl named Cassandra. Young Cassandra read a story one time about some foster children who were forced to drag their belongings in a bin bag from home to home every time they moved. These kids have nothing, she thought to herself. And so upset, she decided to do something about it. And so Cassandra organised a barbecue and with a group of friends decorated 100 pillowcases with fabric markers so that these foster children would have something pretty to carry their belongings in. She and her friends also included in each pillowcase an address book so that the children could keep in touch with family and friends. The pillowcases also had a journal, pens, and a stuffed toy. Over a 3-year period, Cassandra donated more than 1,000 of her goodnight, sleep-tight pillowcases to foster children throughout her area. One of those children is Amy, who's 12. I use the journal every night and I love the stuffed horse. He is so cuddly, says Amy. Like the boy with the fishes and loaves, Cassandra is using what she has to bring happiness to children who have so little. In 2 Kings 4, there is a woman whose husband has died and the creditors are coming to take away her sons as slaves for payment. She cries out to the prophet Elisha for help. Elisha's response is to ask her a question. What do you have in your house? All she had in the cupboard was a little oil, but when she took it and put it in the hands of God, a miracle happened and her needs were met. Whenever we have a need or someone we care about has a need, the first question we need to ask is, what do I have in my house? Are there some fishes and loaves or some oil that God can use in a miraculous way? Before you answer, think about what you have for a moment. It might be some material possession. It might be some talent. But is there something that you have, however small, that God might use to meet someone else's need? A man's wife had died. He was inconsolable. He took flowers to her grave every day. He consulted a minister who counseled him for 3 months. One day, the minister saw the flowers the man had brought to his session, and the minister asked, "Today, I don't want you to go to the police and place those flowers on your wife's grave. I want you to go to St. John's Hospital down the road and go into each room and give a flower to each patient." The next week, when the man came to his session, he's excited. I had a wonderful time giving those flowers away, he said. Those people appreciated them so much, and I made so many friends. I can't stay today for my session, since I'm going back to visit the new friends I made. Are there some fishes and loaves, or pillowcases or flowers in your life that you can use to bring joy into someone else's life? Jesus has compassion for our needs, and he's able to meet our needs. And sometimes he uses us to meet the needs of others. He's able to use us in a wonderful way. Are we willing to take the little we have and let Jesus use it as he would to build up his kingdom here on earth? Amen. Let's dedicate our offering and come before God in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, often we feel like we have little, if anything, to offer you. But by placing our trust in you, like the boy who shared all that he had, offering 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, Jesus can transform whatever we bring into more than enough to meet our world's needs. Loving Lord, you provide for our needs in abundance. Use these, our gifts of money we bring today, and through your blessing, find it multiplied, helping us to really see all that you can do with what we have to offer, in Jesus' name. Gracious God, we give you thanks for all that you give us, for the pleasure of tasty food, for the refreshment of cool drinks, for the fellowship of good friends. We thank you that you meet us when we are tired and weary, but you never send us away empty. You have compassion for our needs. You are able to meet our needs through Jesus Christ, our Saviour, and that in your love, there is always enough. We meet with you that your provision, we praise you that your provision never runs out, that you sometimes even use us to meet the needs of others, able to use us in wonderful, transforming ways, and that you're always ready to meet us in love. God, who feeds your hungry people, we bring you our prayers for our church and our world. We pray for those who experience physical hunger, for farmers surviving on meagre crops and low prices, for parents struggling to feed their children, struggling to make ends meet through furlough or unemployment, for families getting by on cheap food, cut price bargains and handouts. God, who feeds your people, help us to work for a fairer sharing of the world's resources. We pray for those for whom food means difficulty rather than enjoyment, for those who cannot eat because of illness, for those who are experiencing eating disorders or the loathing of their bodies, for those who eat to mask loneliness or unhappiness, those relying on food banks or others to provide for their needs. God, who feeds your people, help us to delight in the simplicity of food. We pray for those whose hunger is not physical, for those alone longing for companionship and friendship, for those depressed searching for meaning and purpose, for those reaching out for an end to grief and pain, for those bereaved, and we pray especially for the family and friends of Betty Brown. God, who feeds your people, help us to welcome others with the good news of your gospel. We pray for ourselves. We seek to live in your way when we are weary and dispirited, when our resources seem stretched to breaking point, when we hunger and thirst for a sense of your presence. And in this moment of silence, we bring to you our own prayers. Lord, enfold those in need in your loving arms and grant them and us your peace. God, who feeds your people, renew us with courage, trust and vision for the future. For we ask these and all our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. Go out into the world rejoicing in God's generous love, and may we be fed by the living God who makes, feeds and sustains the world. And hear us as we say the grace together, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen.